tomorrow all the things were gone. I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Wrestling teaches countless values utilized on and off the mat. One of these is honor, which is earned on the merits of honesty, fairness, and integrity. Pennsylvania has a long and rich tradition in wrestling, producing countless champions and individuals who have honored the sport with their dedication and service, including, but not limited to, Billy Sheridan, Bob Bubb, Gray Simons, Bruce Baumgartner, the Peary family, and the Matter family. Boasting over 500 high school and over 40 college wrestling programs, it is no wonder the Keystone State is hailed as America's hotbed of wrestling. Penn State University has continued the tradition of wrestling success, capturing the NCAA team championship 7 times in 8 years, from 2011 to 2018. The state's rich wrestling history is honored every day by the commitment of those who step on the mat. Men and women who take immense pride in a sport that taught them to be tough, but also fair. Pennsylvania's own Order of Merit recipient, Stan Ziemer, began as a competitor and has continued his involvement in the sport that helped shape his life through many avenues, including years of coaching at various levels, the Hall of Fame, team leader of the U.S. Women's Olympic team, Beat the Streets, Wrestlers in Business, the National Wrestling Coaches Association, and USA Wrestling. His fundraising efforts for the sport in Pennsylvania and across the USA have been incredible. The Pennsylvania chapter of the National Wrestling Hall of Fame is proud to honor the storied wrestling history in the great state of Pennsylvania while looking forward to the future.
Well, it helps in a lot more than my business life. My business life is easy. This is what I was made to do from when I was 2 or 3 years old. And a lot of times I believe you have to try to overcome adversity and turn adversity into advantage. And hard physical work, challenges, bottom lines, competition, that all gives you appreciation and gratitude for the gifts that you've been given. And if you could keep that in mind, then when you're actually in a situation to use those gifts, that background from wrestling, having to overcome things, it in and of itself, the adversity of wrestling is a gift, and it's a gift from the good Lord above. And I would just want to say this too. It's a spiritual thing with me. It was a patriotic thing. Bill Cole was a patriotic man and explained why wrestling was America's sport, the rise of the individual leading to the rise of those around him. And then as I got older, I realized the spirituality of wrestling and the fact that through adversity and belief and faith, you rise to a higher level, and then you can take that to even a further higher level, even in your search for God. That's how I believe it. Well, I thought long and hard about that, and I think it had to do with something Coach Lorenzo said to me. And of course, I didn't wrestle under Rich Lorenzo, but Rich and John, I was going through a tough time, and they brought me on to help out as, some strength training and things like that on the side. But I was talking to Rich about my wrestling career, and Rich was a Jersey wrestler. I was a Jersey wrestler, and Jersey back in those days wasn't that good. And I said, I never wrestled varsity in high school. And I never told anybody that until after I graduated, because after all the studs we had in the room, what's going to happen? If he's a JV wrestler, I'm not going to let him beat me, no matter how long he's been here. But when I told Rich that, he said, he looked at me, and I don't know if he remembers saying this to me, but it hit me. He said, I don't care what you do the rest of your life outside of having your wife and your kids. He said, you will never do what you did coming from a JV background and actually wrestling at Penn State. I have chased that moment in everything I do. It's almost as if, there's a saying, a man's reach must exceed his grasp or what's a heaven for. And that was a case where I match everything against actually walking out on that mat at Penn State. And I think about that all the time, whether it's in my job or in anything I'm doing, that I'm searching for that moment. Well, it's like everything I've ever done in wrestling. I haven't done anything to deserve it. In this sport, I feel that never has someone done so little and gotten so much out of something. And it absolutely blows me away. I've been involved and know so many people in wrestling, and they've all touched my life in a way where I have a great deal of gratitude for that and a great deal of humility about that situation, and understanding that no matter what someone did, they gave more to me than I gave back to them. And that's a very interesting thing to think about. And I guess when I found out about this, I said, I couldn't believe it, and it sort of sums the whole thing up. Another case in wrestling where I'm not deserving of something, and yet there it is.
Joe was born in Providence, Rhode Island. He spent his childhood moving frequently, first to Texas in 1960, then ultimately to Summers Point, New Jersey. While in Texas, his father earned a degree in meteorology and worked in that field until he gave it up because of the impact of the shift work on the family. So it is easy to understand Joe's early interest in the science and his continued thirst for more knowledge in his field. Joe was a member of the wrestling team at Mainland Regional High School in New Jersey, but saw limited action. After high school, Joe attended Penn State University, majoring in meteorology, the top-rated school for meteorology in the country. While engaging in this very challenging major, Joe walked in on the Nittany Lion wrestling team. Hall of Fame coach Bill Cole respected Joe's grit, as he was the workout partner of talent-laden teammates. Joe was the Timex of the team. In practice, he frequently took a licking but kept on ticking. He never gave up. Joe learned a lot about life, battling it out with teammates, the likes of Andy Motter, Jerry Valeco, Jerry White, or Dave Becker. But Joe always thought, what if I never butted heads with them? I would never have learned to fight hard for what you believe in, and you don't turn away from tough challenges. Bill Cole was his coach and spiritual mentor, teaching Joe a lot more than wrestling technique. When Joe graduated in 1978 as a letter winner, he was well-respected by his teammates and well-liked, acquiring the nickname of the Wrestling Weatherman. After college, Joe became a staff meteorologist at AccuWeather in State College and remained there for 32 years, rising to become the chief long-range forecaster. Joe left to join WeatherBell as the chief meteorologist in 2011. Joe has developed a national reputation for using his considerable analytical skills and meteorological experience in conjunction with computer modeling to formulate his forecasts. He continues to be featured as a guest speaker at numerous national and international conferences, and he has incredibly made over 1,000 media appearances on national TV. He's been featured on Fox News Live, ABC World News, The O'Reilly Factor, The Colbert Report, CBS's The Early Show, Imus in the Morning, and several others. Since 1987, Joe has been a volunteer strength and nutrition coach for the Nittany Lion Wrestling Club. He was Kerry McCoy's personal strength coach when he trained for his two Olympic campaigns. Kerry said of Joe, "Our personal and professional relationship grew stronger with each passing day and culminated with me choosing Joe as my personal training coach for the 2000 and 2004 Olympic Games. He was 100% committed to helping me reach my goals. Joe's work ethic and determination to be the best carried over in every area of his life." Additionally, Joe is a national master's class bodybuilder, winning 5 national and 2 North American titles, and currently training for the over 60 nationals. Joe and his wife Jessica continue to reside in Bullsburg. They have 2 children. The Hall of Outstanding Americans demonstrates wrestling's pride in those who have used the disciplines of the sport to launch notable careers in other walks of life. Joe Bastardi, through desire and determination, has done that. Thank you for being an outstanding American, Joe Bastardi. And now, come forward and receive your induction into the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I think the wrestling background helped tremendously on the fact that I learned at an early age through wrestling that you needed to have discipline in what you were doing, and that you had to own what you were doing, not only as a person, because you were part of a team as well as an individual. So you learned early that, you know, hard work and dedication and discipline would help you deliver not only for yourself, but for the team. So as going through the years in business, everything is just the same. You have to deliver to a team, not to yourself. So it taught me that I, you know, need to perform as to not let anyone on my team down. Wrestling in junior high with Bobby Durr and noticing what was required in order to stay ahead of everyone in wrestling. Bobby Durr required the most out of a person, and that was something that I will remember forever. I'll remember the fact that just good wasn't good enough, and he demanded excellence, and my whole life that, you know, played a role in how I was. I look back favorably to those days, even at age 58, so. That would be the event I remember the most. being inducted into the Wrestling Hall of Fame is an honor. I'm humbled to be included in such an elite group of individuals. I think in my younger days, my wrestling coach was Bobby Durr, and I learned very early that wrestling, just like audio, is a 24/7 sport. It wasn't, you know, how much work you did when you were at the practice. It was how much work you did when you were away from the practice. Did you stay in shape? Did you eat healthy? Did you keep your weight down? My biggest lesson I learned early on was there was winning, but then there was winning the way you should win. So there was expectations. Bobby Durr expected the most out of you. And that was, I guess I learned that with Mannheim Township match where we beat Mannheim Township. But when we went to the next practice where we thought we'd be celebrating our victory, he had us run because it wasn't quite what that victory was supposed to be. That's a good life lesson on, you know, you can win, but you can do better. The service industry, which I work in, is very similar to wrestling. What you do off the mat and out of practice is just as important as what you do on.
Troy began wrestling in Warwick Junior High, coached by Hall of Fame member Bobby Durr. Coach Durr taught his wrestlers technique, but also taught honor and dedication to hard work. Those lessons would serve Troy Clare for the rest of his life. Troy wrestled varsity under longtime coach Jerry McDonald, whose teams always were a factor in the Lancaster-Lebanon League. In Troy's senior year, 1978, he was a three-sport letterman and voted Athlete of the Year. After high school, Troy attended Colorado State University, graduating with a Bachelor in Science in Business in 1982. Troy joined the family business immediately after graduating. The company was formed by his father and uncle in the late 60s. A key development occurred when the Clare brothers provided sound for a local Frankie Valli and the Four Seasons concert. The Four Seasons were so impressed with the sound quality, they asked the brothers to tour with them. And so the business that became Clare Brothers Audio Enterprises began. After that, as is said, the rest is history. Clare Brothers eventually ran sound for artists such as Cream, Iron Butterfly, Jefferson Airplane, Elton John, The Moody Blues, Chicago, Yes, Blood, Sweat, and Tears, and others. When the Pope needed a PA at Yankee Stadium, they called the Clare Brothers. Troy cut his teeth in operations until he was called up to the office to become the general manager in 1995. He assumed his current position of 100% ownership in 2007. Troy has grown Clare Global into the largest sound system company in the world with over 650 employees. Clare Global is a star in its own right in the extraordinary competitive international entertainment business, featuring fully owned divisions in Nashville, New York City, and Los Angeles, with affiliates in the UK, Switzerland, Argentina, Japan, and Australia. Virtually most big-name touring performers in most high-end concert halls or arenas use Clare Global audio equipment. Troy consistently demonstrates the values recognized by the Outstanding American Award in his daily personal life and through his distinguished career in the entertainment business. He grew the company into a world leader, building through innovation, vision, calculated risk-taking, and good old hard work, all sound qualities of a wrestler. In 2014, Clare Global and Tate Towers formed Rock Lititz, a joint venture, offering a private and efficient space to prep for live shows of various sizes. With resources ranging from design, engineering, and manufacturing through rehearsals and beyond, Rock Lititz is a one-stop shop to build any show. In addition to that, in early December, Troy arranged studio space at Rock Lititz for filming the question and answer portions of the videos you're watching now of today's inductees. The company sponsors downtown events such as the Rock Lititz Bike Race and the 5K Zombie Run. Troy and the Clare family have been strong supporters of F&M Wrestling for over 50 years. It has a long history of hiring wrestlers as far back as 1976, some of which still work at Clare Global today. Troy actively supports the wrestlers in business Lancaster Network, and he serves his community in three board positions: the Municipal Water and Sewer Authority of Lititz, the Lititz Recreation Center, and the Lancaster EDC. Troy and his wife Katie reside in Lititz, PA. Together they had three children, Sean, Matt, and Gail. The Hall of Outstanding Americans demonstrates wrestling's pride in those who have used the disciplines of the sport to launch notable careers in other walks of life. Troy clearly exemplifies that. Thank you for being the outstanding American that you are, Troy Clair, and congratulations on your induction into the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I went out in eighth grade. I'd never seen a mat before. I'd never seen a wrestling match before. But a guy by the name of Bob Craig came to Newport High School to start wrestling. It was the first year we had high school wrestling. I was the first wrestler on the mat for Newport. I happened to beat the guy. I don't know how that happened, but I happened to beat the guy. But what was more important to me was my father contacted tuberculosis during that period, and had to spend a lot of time in a sanatorium up in Big Mountain. And as a result, I had no one to go to as a male, as a senior male. So Coach pulled me aside and said, Clyde, you want to go right here? He took me wrestling matches, he took me there. He did all kinds of things to get me through that period so that I wasn't spending all my time in the corner of a street in Newport, Pennsylvania. Coach Craig was significant in my life because he gave me the guidance that I needed, good, clean guidance. He got me in a sport that kept me physically well and introduced me to a lot of men that I consider men of integrity. These are men that now talk about wrestling rather than wrestle. Gray Simons was considered the quarter of a century finest wrestler ever wrestled for the United States, particularly the Olympics. But Gray Simons was to wrestle me in Shippensburg. I was at Shippensburg and I wrestled Gray Simons. And Wednesday of the match, Coach stopped me and says, Clyde, you don't have to really wrestle him. He said, if you decide you want to back out of this, you can back out. I said, well, who am I wrestling, Coach? Said Gray Simons, so I'm a undefeated freshman, and he's undefeated. So what? So it should be a good match. Well, 11-0 was the final score. Gray Simons obviously had the 11 points. I had the 0 points. Then to end it all, he was a nice guy because he came over, talked to my father and me, and took time out of his busy schedule to spend a little time telling me. Help me out a little, some moves and some things like that. But that has to be the peak of my career was the fact that not that I wanted P-Sacks, that wasn't as important as having kept on the mat with Gray Simons, at least he let me keep on the mat with him, and getting a standing ovation from the crowd who really appreciated what I accomplished. It means more than anyone can ever guess. I really have, when I graduated from college, I didn't go into the wrestling program in any schools or anything like that, but I went to pharmacy school. So I put wrestling as a side thing. Then all of a sudden, after 45 years, the gentleman called me up and said, wrestling, Clyde, and I had helped some folks reach their goals financially, but it really is an honor to be able to say that I'm a member of such a fine group of people because I never met a wrestler I didn't like.
Clyde wrestled at Newport High School for legendary Hall of Fame coach Bob Craig. Clyde credits Coach Craig with bringing him out of his shell and encouraging him to wrestle. This changed Clyde's life. At Newport, Clyde had a career record of 60-10 and was a two-time District 3 champ. In his senior year of 1961, he was the Southeast Regional Champion at 112 pounds and the school's first qualifier to states. Clyde attended Shippensburg State College, earning a B.S. in elementary education. He had a record of 24-4-1 over three seasons. In 1962, he won the very tough Pennsylvania State College Conference title at 115 pounds. The always incredibly competitive PSAC featured some of the best programs in the country during those years. Shipp took third place at the 1961 PSAC Championships and had a 9-2 dual meet record. Shippensburg was also third in the PSAC in 1962, the year Clyde won his conference crown. Clyde briefly taught sixth grade in the Cumberland Valley School District, then attended the University of Pittsburgh School of Pharmacy, graduating in 1969. In 2 years, he opened his first pharmacy. Clyde was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease in 1998, but that did not slow down his drive, nor his love of people and wrestling. The discipline of wrestling enabled Clyde to handle the challenges of Parkinson's and still maintain an extremely busy professional lifestyle, as well as his love for his sport. Today, he owns Care Capital Management, which owns and operates 18 medicine shop pharmacies in Pennsylvania and New York. Clyde has been a generous and longtime supporter of the sport his whole life. He has sponsored international wrestlers, including Sean O'Day and Olympic medalist Bruce Bumgarner. He's provided apparel for the Newport Wrestling Team for their holiday tournament and to Team Diesel Wrestling, which sends wrestlers to the Disney Duels. He also financially assisted Newport High School in securing a scoreboard and new wrestling room in 2008. Also in 2008, he started the Clyde L. Kressler Family Wrestling Scholarship at Edinburgh University, and also the Clyde L. Kressler Wrestling Scholarship at Shippensburg University. Clyde has mentored children individually, in addition to his strong history of supporting wrestling. He was inducted into the District 3 Wrestling Coaches Hall of Fame in 2002 and was the recipient of the Bob Craig Youth Service Awards in 2012. Then in 2017, Clyde was inducted into the Shippensburg University Hall of Fame. For several years while battling Parkinson's, Clyde took weekly ballroom dance lessons with his wife Carol at Arthur Murray Dance Studio in Lemoyne. To Clyde, ballroom dancing was like a temporary cure because symptoms seemed to disappear during the lessons. While still a student at Shippensburg, Clyde married Carol Moore, class of 1966. Clyde and Carol have been married for 54 years and have a son and daughter-in-law who are raising their two grandchildren. The Medal of Courage is presented to a wrestler or former wrestler who has overcome what appears to be insurmountable challenges, which may be physical, mental, or other disabilities that make their achievements all the more uplifting. We don't know where you can find an individual or a career more uplifting than that of Clyde Kressler. Congratulations, Clyde, and welcome to the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I used to roll around in the practice room with the guys now and then, and Dick Rhodes saw that I had some interest in wrestling, so one day he asked me if I'd like to be a junior high assistant coach. And I was honored to be the coach, and it was a good year, but the next year then he asked me to step up the varsity. And since I was a business teacher, there were a lot of things that I could do for the wrestling program, for instance, paperwork, statistics, programs, fundraisers, weigh-ins. I assisted in helping even run tournaments, the conditioning of the wrestlers, and many other things that people wanted me to do. They even let me drive the van. I loved being part of the Bald Eagle coaching staff. God bless me when he gave me a spot on the Bald Eagle wrestling program. After I retired from Bald Eagle, I was honored by the Penn State Wrestling Club to be their treasurer. This classy, hardworking group of people is some of the best people I have ever been around. The championship season we had in 1999 is one for the history books in Bald Eagle. That year we won Mannheim. We won the Beast of the East, Districts, Regionals, the first ever team state tournament. We won the state tournament. With that also, we were named the best high school team in the nation, which was a very, very great honor for all of us. Along with those great honors, there was an embarrassing moment I'd like to tell you about that happened at the state tournament. Someone handed me the trophy after we were done taking pictures and things, and somehow I dropped the trophy. And I didn't just drop it, I broke the little wrestler off the top of the trophy, and people weren't very happy with me right then, but we sent it to our trophy man when we got back home, and everything was fine, and he said nobody would ever know it. Well, little did he know I was going to tell 400 people about this little event. Besides this, one of the major things that really I loved about wrestling was the friendships and relationships I made through the decades that I was involved in the wrestling program. They are probably more important to me now than they were even then. This is quite an honor and means the world to me, and at the same time, it's sort of unbelievable. When I got a letter in the mail from the National Wrestling Coaches Association, I first thought that my dues were overdue. And so when I opened it up, though, I read it, and then I read it a second time, and then I had my wife read it, and then we thought, oh my, this is great. And it was a wow moment in my life that shivers ran up and down my back. And it still feels sort of incredible that this is actually happening to me. And I'm so proud and humbled to be with the inductees today and of all the other people who have come before me.
Don graduated from Pins Valley High School in 1967 and Bloomsburg University in 1971, where he was an honor student and collected a degree in business education. Don did not wrestle at either institution, but as anyone in central Pennsylvania knows, both schools had superior programs in that time, and Don saw a lot of good wrestling. After college, Don was hired at Bald Eagle area as a business ed teacher. A year earlier, Hall of Famer Dick Rose had been hired as BEA's head wrestling coach. The two young teachers became good friends. In 1979, since he had been showing interest in the wrestling program, Coach Rhodes asked Don if he would like to be an assistant coach, despite not having a background as a wrestler. Coach Rhodes had a special niche plan for Don, in which he knew Don could perform well and benefit the program. Don was assigned responsibility for team conditioning. Being a dedicated runner, including appearances in the Boston Marathon, added to his abilities to condition wrestlers. Don worked the team hard in running or drilling to build the wrestler's stamina. Don also was responsible for oversight of the team records, publications, logistics, etc. His skills as a business teacher aided him extraordinarily well in organizing that portion of his job. He was a great conditioning coach, and his interaction with the team members and other coaches aided greatly in BEA's reputation as being in top-notch condition and dominating the third period. BEA wrestlers never ran out of gas when Don Burris was training them. For the next 22 years, Don worked the team's conditioning. BEA became a state power in the 80s and a national power in the 90s. In that time span, BEA won 290 meets, suffered only 29 losses. BEA had 5 undefeated seasons, 13 district championships, and 6 regional titles, and was ranked number 1 in the state at least 4 years during that time. Then, in 1999, despite being a small school district, BEA finished the season as the top-ranked team in the nation. Much of that attributes to the efforts of Don Burris making sure BEA wrestlers would out-condition their opponents. All the while, Don also organized all team events, programs, tournaments, travel details, weight certification requirements, and any other administrative duties. Usually, he even drove one of the team vans when the team traveled. Believe us, you have not lived until you've ridden with Don Baja Burris behind the wheel. The wrestlers were always energized after riding with Coach Burris. Don's fun-loving personality worked as a great stress reliever before matches, allowing the wrestlers to do their best on the mat. Don also served as the secretary of the District 6 Coaches Association for 23 years. Don continues to support our sport as the treasurer for the Penn State Wrestling Club, the largest fan-based wrestling club in the U.S. for nearly 10 years. Don contributed to overhauling the institutional control efforts of the Penn State Wrestling Club and formalized many of the practices and procedures to better manage the funding of the nation's largest wrestling support club. He is currently serving as the secretary for the Center County chapter of the Pennsylvania Sports Hall of Fame, but is transitioning to the treasurer position as his wife Bonnie is taking over as the chapter secretary. Don and Bonnie still reside in State College. They have been married for just under 50 years and had two children together. Thank you, Don Burris, for your years of coaching and promoting our great sport and for building your program into the pride of the community. Welcome into the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
Chuck never wrestled in high school or in college because of an injury that he sustained in a high school gym class. And ironically, it was wrestling in gym class that he broke his ankle quite badly and had a number of surgeries and had pins inserted. And it just never kept him from wanting to learn. When he started teaching, he was at the middle school, and he helped with the soccer team, but he started the wrestling program at the middle school and just went to clinics, spent summers going to coaching clinics, and one of the coaches at the high school said to him, "You are a great motivator and you can always learn the techniques of the sport, but you'll work well with the kids." It was a good thing, because when he broke that ankle in high school, he was in our local hospital for a few weeks, and I was a candy striper who volunteered a couple days a week at the hospital, and that's how we met. So a good thing came out of that broken ankle. Well, he coached for so long, there are a lot of memorable ones. I think the things that come to mind are the 83 upset of Harriton. Harriton was such a strong powerhouse in our area that, there were actually coaches who told him, "Don't even go, because you're going to embarrass yourself, and you should just forfeit the match." And they ended up upsetting Harriton, and that was a big deal. And the year you beat Ridley. Ridley had been on a three-season, 38-match undefeated streak, and Sun Valley beat Ridley one year. Over all the years, he made such an impact on his wrestlers, and I think that, in looking back, that, you know, there were plenty of wins, there were undefeated seasons, but I think it was the impact that he had on his wrestlers. You know, he always preached to his wrestlers that being a good wrestler comes second to being a good person. Well, I think people who know Chuck know how humble he always was. He was not a coach that said, "I got a win," or "I did this." He always gave credit to his assistant coaches, his kids, gave them credit for how hard they worked. And even like when he got his 200th win. He specifically told the newspaper that he did not want them to do a preview article because he didn't want his kids knowing that it would be their 200th. And so after the fact, then the paper did a big article. But that was very typical of him. But I think getting this honor, he realized that over the years, he did do something right.
Chuck graduated from Ridgely High School in 1964. He never wrestled for the varsity squad because he broke his leg wrestling in a physical education class, requiring surgery and the installation of two pins and a protracted hospital stay. But the positive takeaway is that he met his wife, Mary Ann, there, as she was volunteering as a candy striper. Nearly 55 years later, they are still married and have two children and still live in Aston. Chuck suffers from a medical condition, which robs him of his ability to speak well, though he clearly understands and communicates in other ways. That is why Mary Ann provided the answers to his interview questions. With 55 years together, they both know what the other is thinking, and answering for Chuck was an easy chore for Mary Ann. And we thank you. His mentor in high school was Coach Carl Schnellenbach, who had been recruiting Chuck prior to his career-ending injury. He took Chuck under his wing in phys ed class and taught him a lot about the sport, about competition, and about life. Chuck soaked up everything Coach Schnellenbach taught about wrestling and eventually went on to a highly successful 27-year career as Sun Valley's head wrestling coach. Chuck graduated from the Pennsylvania Military College, now known as Widener University, in 1968. After college, he taught at Delaware County Community College and began coaching. Chuck started the wrestling program at Northley Middle School in 1969, then moved to Sun Valley High School as the head coach, remaining there from 1972 to 2001. And as many coaches who were never wrestlers, Chuck called upon his other innate skills to lead his teams to success. He worked just as hard teaching his athletes the traits to become successful men as he did teaching them to become successful wrestlers. In addition to being a great coach, as a teacher, Chuck's door was open to any student seeking help for schoolwork or for personal matters. Several students with school difficulties and social issues were mentored and encouraged by Chuck and eventually graduated from high school and college. One of his former wrestlers said it best. When I was in high school, my father was diagnosed with cancer, passed away when I was only 17. During that time, Chuck became my mentor and a supportive father figure. Despite the stress, I learned to balance the negatives with positive thinking and logic practices that continue to benefit me in life to this day. Chuck also guided me in the college application process at a time when it was difficult to focus. I was offered a college wrestling scholarship because he taught me to be a good wrestler. I majored in teaching in college because I wanted to be like him. Chuck's career record as head coach is 321, 121, and 6, and he coached undefeated teams in 1975 and 1985. Throw in another 5 years as a junior high coach before he became the head coach, Chuck has 32 years in the sport. He founded the Delaware Valley Coaches Association in 1981 and has been a member of the District 1 Steering Committee from 1988 to 2005. After retiring as head coach, he stayed on at Sun Valley as an assistant for two more seasons. Chuck is a member of four Halls of Fame: the Southeast Pennsylvania Wrestling, the Pennsylvania Wrestling Coaches Association, the Delaware County and Aston Halls of Fame. The National Wrestling Hall of Fame will be his fifth Hall of Fame. Thank you, Chuck Rossano, for your years of coaching and serving the youth in your areas so well. The term wrestling family applies so well to you and your history. Welcome into the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I had a neighbor who was on the wrestling team, and he told me that they needed a 154-pounder. So I went and got a permission slip, and I gave it to my dad to sign. And he would not sign it, right? He said, "I don't want you to get hurt." I was really upset, and I walked out the front door of the house, and when I got down the steps, halfway down the steps, I heard my mother came out the door, and she said, "Richard," he said, "here, I signed it." My father, you know, once I got started into the wrestling, then my father came to watch me wrestle. Well, Al was a football coach. At one point I coached football, and he and I coached football together, and then he helped me with wrestling. I say my son was a state champion. It was, you know, that was memorable, you know, when he won the state championship, right? And also, I wrestled at Albright College, and I won the Mid-Atlantic Conference Championship, and that was very memorable. 52 years, I said, I've been coaching. I'm very proud, because it's something that I've done all my life.
Dick attended Reading High School, where he participated in both football and wrestling. He began participating on the wrestling team in 1959, graduating in 1962. He then attended Albright College, where he became a standout in both the wrestling team and the football program. In football, he was a two-year starter at guard, and in wrestling, he compiled a 32-14 career record and won a Middle Atlantic Conference title at 177 pounds in his junior year, the last Albright wrestler to win a title. He graduated in 1966. Dick began his coaching career as an assistant in North Hunterdon, New Jersey. After a year there, in 1969, he moved back to Reading and started the wrestling program at Wyomissing High School, coaching there till 1980. He then became the coach at his alma mater, Albright College, for one season before moving to Governor Mifflin High School for two seasons. Dick then took a hiatus in coaching to focus on his two sons' outstanding wrestling careers. His son Peter was a state runner-up in 1986 and won a state championship in 1987. And Matt was also a two-time medalist. Both competed for Schuylkill Valley. Peter went on to wrestle for Penn State and Old Dominion, where he was the Old Dominion University Male Athlete of the Year. Both Peter and Matt have gone on to be the head wrestling coaches for several years. Looking back on his taking a break to focus on his sons, Dick said, "I've always felt privileged to be involved with my son's wrestling, and now my grandchildren's wrestling. It's something I really enjoy. I made a decision when I was in college I wanted to be a coach. I've been able to do it ever since." His grandson, Noah, won titles in District 3 in Class AA for Schuylkill Valley. Dick returned as the head coach at Wyomissing for two seasons, then stepped down to become an assistant coach. Dick finished his head coaching career with 81 wins at Wyomissing and Governor Mifflin, but he continued as an assistant coach at Schuylkill Valley, where he still coaches today. That's a total of 37 years in coaching, and seven different decades of his being involved in our great sport as a wrestler or a coach. Coach Dale Maurer's squads at Schuylkill Valley, in the years with Dick as an assistant, have garnered well over 300 wins. Dick is a member of the Berks Wrestling Hall of Fame, the District 3 Wrestling Coaches Association Hall of Fame, and the Albright College Hall of Fame. Dick and his wife, Dee, live in Leesport and have three children. Congratulations on your induction, Dick Horst, and thank you for truly a lifetime of service to the sport of wrestling. Please come forward to claim your plaque.
I got to blame it all on Bobby Horning. He was a just a kid in the neighborhood, a lot older than me, kind of a guy I looked up to. Everyone in my neighborhood was basketball players, and I was the worst basketball player of all time. Never saw a wrestling mat, never was involved. And he kept telling me, you gotta be a wrestler. So I went to a clinic run by Coach Kellen, who is also a member of the Hall of Fame. And he kind of got me started. From then on, I've been wrestling, you know, since I was 11 or 12. So I feel very fortunate to be involved in such a great sport. And Coach Kellen is the one that got me involved in it. One of the things that he took a personal interest in you. I mean, wrestling was important, but it was always about you and the things you were doing at that time. He was always asking about your family or something like that. It wasn't just, hey, we're wrestling today, guys. Here's what we're doing. And he was my junior high coach and my high school coach. So the most memorable event in all my years of wrestling was probably the 1993-94 District 1 Dual Meet Championships. And the reason for it is I kind of had, you know, three parts of it. It was begun because we came up with an idea with the steering committee. It was run at Wissahickon High School, where I was the coach. And we ran the tournament, and finally we were the number one seed, got in, and were able to fortunately win it. So it was a thing where we administered it, we ran it, and we won it. It was just a fantastic combination of coming together with all three parts of wrestling. It's unbelievable, unexpected, even for me a little bit embarrassing. I've been around wrestling since I was like 10 or 11 years old, always kind of on the periphery, kind of like a guy who was an extra with all these stars around. To finally be inducted in the Hall of Fame is just something I can't believe. I hope I'm not embarrassing all the great people that are in there. I saw some of the groups that went in there this year and in years past, and it's just so nice to be included with such a great group of people in wrestling.
Jeff attended Methacton High School, graduating in 1974 as a regional medalist. His coach was Hall of Famer and PA board member Denny Kellen. After high school, Jeff enrolled at Boston University and was a member of the wrestling team there. He graduated in 1978 after fashioning a fine career record of 64-18. Jeff was a team captain at Boston University as he won a Yankee League crown and led his team to the league title. Right after college, Jeff got his start in coaching as an assistant at Wissahickon High School for 4 years. Then in 1983, he became the head coach there and led the Trojans to 257 dual meet wins over the next 23 years. Jeff then moved on to Perkiomen Valley as an assistant coach for 3 seasons before becoming the head coach at Pottsgrove High School in 2008. Jeff is still the head coach at Pottsgrove. Entering the 2018-19 season, Jeff has fashioned a career record of 320-239. Jeff won 12 league titles at Wissahickon, including 7 straight from 1988 to 1994. His Trojans won 2 sectional titles and won both the dual and team District 1 titles in 1994. He has been selected as Coach of the Year 13 times. His Pottsgrove Falcons won the Pioneer Athletic Conference League title in 2018. He has coached 3 PIAA runners-up, Steve Pyle in 1993, Brad Canterbury in 2003, and Pat Finn in 2014. Aside from his high school coaching responsibilities, Jeff has been very active in planning and presenting wrestling clinics in the off-season. He has instructed at clinics at Methacton, Plymouth White Marsh, Owen J. Roberts, Great Valley, Spring Ford, and Pottsgrove. He also coached freestyle at the following clubs: Evil Hill, Methacton, and Chessmont, combination of O.J. Roberts and other schools. Most recently, he coached spring-summer folk style at Team Revolution at Spring Ford High School. Jeff is a member of the District 1 Wrestling Steering Committee since 1982 and has served as chairman, voting representative, and currently the assistant chair. Since 1993, Jeff has been the chairman of the District 1 Dual Meet Championships and has served in 2 lengthy stints as president of the District 1 Coaches Association, 1986 through 1988, and 2005 to present time. He is in his 42nd year of coaching wrestling. One of Jeff's former wrestlers, who was now a teacher and a coach, said Coach Madden's true gift to the sport of wrestling is that he is able to set an extremely high standard for athletes, and he is there to help each individual meet that standard. Coach Madden is always there for his wrestlers. As a young athlete who struggled in school, I can personally attest to this. What better compliment can be paid to a coach than that? Jeff and his wife Colleen have three children, live in Royersford. Thank you for your lifetime of service that you are still continuing, Jeff Madden, and thank you for being a great representative of our sport. Welcome to the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.
I started in wrestling at the age of 10. I was in fourth grade, and a guy by name Joe Humphrey walked into my classroom and gave a speech to the students, mainly the boys, about the sport of wrestling. They were just getting it started at our school, and he told us that you didn't have to be 250 pounds to play football. You don't have to be 6'5" to play basketball. You can be any size, any age, and you're going to wrestle somebody about your size, about your age. And the question you have to ask yourself, who's better, him or you? And I sat there in that chair and got excited inside and said to myself, I'm better. I'm the better one. He didn't know that he was fishing for wrestlers that day. And we all bit the hook, line, and sinker, took it hook, line, and sinker. I was a junior in high school. I was wrestling in district finals against Henry Green, one of our great wrestlers here in Pennsylvania. He led the whole match. 8 seconds to go, I took him down. I scored 2 points. The 8 seconds wiped away a riding time point that he had. He controlled the whole match. But when I did that, I went up by one, and I won the district championship that year as a junior. Secondly, I had a brother, Paul, our youngest brother of five brothers, win a state championship. And that day, I was there. He won. They raised his hand. And I ran out on the mat to be with the coaches, and he ran into our arms. I would have to say that is one of the tops as well. That he, there was five brothers in our family. I think all of us had potential to be state champs. But our youngest brother, he finished it up for us. And we're all proud of that for him. I'm very honored, very privileged, and I'm very humbled because it's being inducted into the Pennsylvania chapter of the National Award Hall of Fame. You never think you're worthy or need to be worthy, but all of a sudden somebody looks at you and says, yes, he's worthy. And I'm very honored and I appreciate what has been done. Do I really deserve this? I didn't do this to be honored like this, and it is a great honor. I did it for the love of the sport, for the love of wrestling, for the love of coaching. It was just it changed my life. Started at age 10, and it changed my life, and here I am. It's still affecting me. Basically, I just want to thank Also, Dick Rhodes. You know, Joe Humphrey has started this out. Dick Rhodes came in to our the Bald Eagle Area program when I was a junior and just carried on what Joe had started and basically took it over the top for the next 20, 30 years and did a great job. And I appreciate the Dick Rhodes for what he did for me and got me started. And lastly, Bill Cole, Penn State University coach. He brought us through. Brought me through the college years, and so I'm very proud that I've had great coaches through my entire career. I was fortunate.
Wayne got his start in wrestling in the elementary program at Bald Eagle Area, started by Hall of Fame coach Joe Humphreys. Joe was a true father figure to the five Packer brothers, and coached Wayne 1 year at the varsity level at BEA. Coach Humphreys then moved on to assist on the wrestling team and teach at Penn State University. Then another Hall of Famer became Wayne's coach. Dick Rhodes coached Wayne in his last two seasons at BEA. On the right of this photo was also one of today's inductees, Don Burris. Wayne had a phenomenal high school career, compiling a career record of 56-6 with 25 falls. He was 31-2 in dual meet competition. Wayne was a two-time District 6 champion, 1 year as the outstanding wrestler, a two-time Central Northwestern regional champion, and a two-time PIAA semifinalist. One of his notable victories was a historic win over Henry Green in the District 6 tournament to earn the Outstanding Wrestler Award. Wayne then attended Penn State on a full scholarship and was a three-year starter at 118 pounds. He excelled on the team, building a career record of 40-8-2 under head coach Hall of Famer Bill Cole. Wayne became the first ever Eastern Wrestling League champion in league history when the Lions moved from the EIWA to the newly formed EWL. He was ranked nationally for the Nittany Lions, the highest being a number 4 ranking in the country during his senior year. Wayne graduated from Penn State in 1976. After college, Wayne began coaching and teaching at West Hazleton High School. He initiated a junior high program where there had previously been none and was its first coach for two seasons. Then, Wayne was named the varsity head coach for the Cougars, where he remained for the next 7 years. He coached the school's first ever District 11 champion and its first PIAA place winner and finalist. In 1989, he moved to Lampeter Strasburg as the head coach. In 9 seasons, Wayne coached over 100 wins for the Pioneers, was named the Coach of the Year for the Lancaster-Lebanon Wrestling League section 3 times. Then in 1992, Wayne was named the District 3 Coach of the Year. At the conclusion of the 1998 season, after a total of 20 years of coaching, Wayne retired from coaching and became the athletic director. In 2008, he retired from that position. Wayne is a member of the Bald Eagle Area Wrestling Hall of Fame and was selected first team on BEA's All-50-Year team in 2006. He and his wife, Doreen, split their time between Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and Venice, Florida. They have 2 sons. Congratulations of a great lifetime as a competitor, coach, and athletic administrator, Wayne Packer, as you become the second member of your family to enter the National Wrestling Hall of Fame.